Well, good morning, Epic Church. How is everybody? Man, it's good to see all of y'all. How many of you are stoked about sub-zero weather in Alabama? So I will, on behalf of however it works, apologize that this time a week ago it was like 100 degrees outside and today it's 15. So I don't really know why Alabama's like that, but it just is. So if you're like me, your sinuses has decided to unleash and just run and your eyes are watering. But you chose to be here today, so thank you so much. If this is your first time here, my name's Ivy Marsh. You've met my beautiful wife. We're the lead pastors here. And let me just say this as we begin second week in the new series entitled Inaugurate that we're in today. I absolutely believe in you. I absolutely love you in Jesus. And I am excited about what 2017 holds for you individually, your marriage, your single life, your single and raising kids life, or married and raising kids life, your job life, every aspect of your life, I do believe, is going to be way, way better than any year you've had thus far. And here's why I believe that. I don't believe that just because I hope that happens. I'm not even agreeing with your hope. I'm agreeing with your faith. I'm agreeing with the instruction that God's going to give us this entire year to change the very thing that we need to change so our lives will, if I could use this phrase, bear fruit. If you're in here and you're not of the church, really, like, what does that mean? Well, so that your life can be, honestly, more successful. Your life can have a lot to it and all the things that you want, which is not necessarily stuff. Everybody say stuff. Most of the time we gauge life and how successful we are based on the amount of stuff that we accumulate, and that's not an indicator of God's success. An indicator of God's success is that we would grow in love for Him, for each other, that peace would be the thing that overtakes us when trials come our way, that joy is never stolen from us. All those things that we talk about in private conversations between you and God or maybe a best friend. I just wish my life would be more peaceful. I wish I could have a little bit more joy because things seem to be getting haywire. How many of you experienced some haywire moments in 2016? And there's all this stuff that happens, and the success, living life to the fullest, having all that God would have you to have, is no matter what happens in this world, you have this sense of undeniable peace that your Father loves you, that He's moving in your direction, that He's working all things out for your good, that there's a whole nother level that you are going to move to in 2017. So I want to start this conversation out by saying, I believe that for you. I really do. I think this is going to be an amazing, amazing year for you because you're sitting in this place today and we're going to talk about the very thing that needs to change in your life. Let me tell you what doesn't need to change. It's stuff. Let me tell you what doesn't need to change. Your job. Your marriage. What I mean by that is you don't have to trade anybody in and get another one. Let me tell you what's not going to change. Your kids. They're still going to be your kids. Like, so the idea for most of us is, well, I have to change some stuff in my life. And really, that's not it. What you have to change, really, and what God would say, is you have to change the way you think. You have to change your belief system. I am a firm believer in Romans 12:2, that if you will not conform to how the world says to think, but you'll really, really conform to God's way of thinking, your entire life will be changed forever and ever and ever and ever. And the Bible goes on to say in Romans 12:3 that you will know what God's will is for your life. Like, it'll just become this thing that opens up. So inaugurate, you're like, why did you pick that title for this series? Because the definition is this: to introduce a new system. Look at your neighbor and say, we're about to do something new. Initiate, start, begin, launch, commence, or establish. So we began this last week, and we're just a few days into 2017, and you don't have to raise your hand or say amen. I mean, if you want to, that's okay. But how many of you, like, you're just a few days into 2017, and it's really feeling a lot like 2016? Like, it hadn't changed all that much. Like, there's some things that started, but they've kind of already fizzled out. How many of you just, like, you feel this eerie feeling that it's not a lot like 16, but it sure does feel like 15. Like there's some things you're starting to repeat or to relive. How many married people in here? So here's the deal. How many of you have already fought in 2017 over something you fought in 2016? Like, you already had a heated discussion. Let's don't say fight. Let's say we had, here's all my church people. You had intense fellowship. How many of you know that? Like, we're just discussing it at a high level. Okay, so like, but it was something that you, how many of you have already talked to your kids about something they did in 2016 that they're still doing in 2017? They're like, you came home late all 2016. Can't you be on time? Can't you make the grade? Can't you, like, I know they've been out of school and they're on your nerve. I got all that, but I'm just saying, like, we find ourselves repeating sometimes the same conversations. How many single people are believing for a man or a woman in 2017 just like you did in 2016? Go ahead, single people, raise your hand. Raise your hand. How many single people in the house? All single people, stand up. Look around the room. Look around the room. They are a bunch of single people needing a spouse up in here. Y'all can have a seat, okay? We like to call that an epic, a holy hookup. You're in church. God just ordained that I made everybody stand up, so now the rest is up to you. Why do I say that? Because if we stay in the same mindset, we don't realize that we do this, but if we stay in the same mindset that we had in 2016, can I just tell you what's going to happen? 2017 is going to look the same. And when 18 gets here, it's going to look the same. And when 19 gets here, it's going to look the same. And you're going to wake up one day and you're going to be like, how did I just stay the same the whole time? Like, I haven't really gained much ground. There's not been a lot of changes to my marriage or my children or my single life or my job life. It hasn't been a lot. Let me tell you why I've found this to be true in my life. Because I never changed my belief system. I never changed the way I thought. And there's a really cool invitation in the book of Ephesians where God says, I want you, if I say me, to imitate me as little kids, as little children. God invites us as his people to imitate him as his little children. Now, that's a very different concept. How many of you in here have children? Okay, great. Here's what I know about you on some level. This may not be true on all levels, but here's what I know about you on some level. How many of you would love it if your children didn't make the same mistakes you made at 17? Yeah. How many of you would just dig that and be like, whew, that'd be sick. Win, okay? How many would love it if your kids didn't make the same mistakes you made at 21? Yeah. So here's kind of what we don't think of it this way, but here's what we think. Man, if I could take my wisdom. What is wisdom? Wisdom is knowledge and experience put together to know what to do with the knowledge I have. So there's some of you that have knowledge of an experience that you had that you don't want to do again. That's right. Amen? How many of you got that t-shirt and burned it? Okay. How many of you dropped it like it was hot in PCB and you're not going back? Okay. So you go, I ain't doing that. Could tell you all kind of stories about Pastor Benet, but I won't. What's up, girl? That girl got the Daisy Dukes on. All right, so dial back in. So, how many of y'all know what I'm talking about? Not that you know where Pastor Benet was, but for you, you know what that looks like. Ah, Lee, man, I don't want. And so, in us as moms and dads, we have this thing that says, if I could somehow just take out of me wisdom and put into my child where they know at 16 what I now know at 40. Because all of us have said this. If I could go back, how many of you have said this? If I could, time machine, if I could just go back and know what I know now. Now, there's an age limit where you would go back to. None of us would go back to 13. We're just not going to endure that. But there's a place where you would, like, you go back so far. Maybe it's 16, maybe it's 20. I don't know where it kind of went sideways for you. But we have all said this, man, if I could go back to when I was this age and know what I know now, there's only about 50,000 decisions that I would do different. Here's what people say all the time. And I really don't buy this. I wouldn't change a thing. I think you're lying to me and you. Because I'm just going to be honest with you, there's a whole list of stuff that I would change. So let's start on that same place. And so here's what we have. Everybody say legacy. Here's what we have, an opportunity as older people. What does that mean? It means you're older than somebody. So everybody in here is older than somebody. Okay? The ones that are laughing are a lot older than somebody. Right. I'm older than everybody in here. Okay, so like as people older than somebody, we have the opportunity to truly help them not make the same mistakes. Like, we really do. And it doesn't matter if you're in high school, middle school, college, just starting out in work, just starting out in marriage, or you're a little bit on in years. Like, you can learn from somebody everywhere along the journey. And what we're working toward is learning how to have legacy thinking. Look at your neighbor and say, think legacy. Now look at your other and say, think legacy. Because people don't think this way. We make decisions for now. We make decisions for yesterday. What does that mean? I made a mistake, so I'll make a different decision today. But we never really look out toward the future. And at best, you look at when you're going to die or retire. But here's what legacy thinking is. Legacy thinking is thinking about my kids, whether you have them or not. I'm thinking about my children. I'm thinking about my grandchildren. I'm thinking about my grandchildren's kids. Because the Bible says that once you kind of tap into living life God's way, he promises to bless 1,000 generations that come after you. 1,000. Now, that's a big chunk to kind of chew off mentally, but it's where God invites us to. But he says, I want you to imitate me as little kids. What is he saying? If you're going to imitate somebody, if you're going to do what I do, let's just say it was me, and I would say, hey, I need you to imitate me. Here's what you'd have to know. How I think. You can't just know my behavior, because what you'll do is you'll get away from me and you will make decisions on an assumption. You have to really learn how I think, how I view things, how does my brain process things, and how do I view life, and how do I view circumstances. And so if you could do that, if you could learn to think like I think, then you would begin to act like I act. You would see life as I see life. You would make decisions the way I would make decisions. You know what you want as a parent? You want your kids to be able to do that, but not as your 16-year-old self. You want your kids to be able to do that at your 40-year-old self. You want them to say, look, little person. I'm not the smartest or the sharpest tool in the box, but I'm just telling you, I've come through a lot. I really do know more than you. Maybe not about geometry, but about life. How many of y'all know geometry homework is hard? Whew. My daughter's in the 7th grade, and I'm out. I'm like, I don't know what X and Y is, okay? So, like, but here's the deal. I know some things about life, and I really want her to get it. Why? Because I don't want her to make the same mistakes as me. I want her to, at the end of the day, be able to stand on my shoulders and build off my success. Not any of my failures, but everything I've succeeded at. I'll share my failures, but I want her to really get how to think like I think right now. I want my two sons, one's 21, one's 18, to stand on mine and Benet's shoulders in the home that we have built. And I'm not talking about square footage house. I'm talking about the belief system, the ideology, the philosophy that lines up with Scripture to say, listen, guys, you don't have to go out and make your own way, make the same mistakes I made. If you'll just sit down and listen, if I could just take this out and place it in you, you are going to be so far ahead of the game. That's going to be amazing. Everybody say legacy thinking. That's what legacy thinking is. And we started out with Psalms 90 as kind of our base verse. It says this, Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. We said this last week. God's never been in question about who he is. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. Our days may come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures, yet the best of them are but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass and we fly away. Teach us, everybody say, teach me. Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your glory or your splendor to their children. Verse 17 is our series prayer. I hope it'll be your year prayer. May the favor of the Lord our God rest on us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. How many of you have dreams in your life? Like, you can close your eyes right now and see the marriage that you hope to have. How many of you single people can close your eyes and have a picture of the spouse that you hope to have? How many have the dream of having children? You're in here and you don't have any, but you dream of having them. You can close your eyes and I want two boys and one girl, or I want two girls and one boy, or however that works for you. How many of you have a dream that you hope to have a house, own your own home one day? Raise your hand on that one. Hope to own my own home. How many of you have a dream to hope to get a promotion this year? You're in your job, like, well, I'm I'm climbing the ladder, and that's okay. How many of you have a dream and you hope to have more joy this year? You hope to have more peace this year. You hope to have more patience this year. If you've asked for that, I can assure you God will help you with that, okay? So here's what I want you to understand. There is a difference between dreams, everybody say dreams, and visions. Now, we don't understand that, and there's some of you that would like to argue with it, and that's okay. You would be wrong, and so I'm going to try to help you bring it to the truth side. If you heard what I said, dreams are just that. I hope to have. I hope. Hoping really doesn't get you anywhere. How many of you can remember middle school dreaming of being outside playing in English? But you opened your eyes and you were what? Still in English. I understand you're like, well, Pastor, it's not like I could make that happen. I'd get an F. I mean, I guess you could run out of class. I'd get to go to the principal. I mean, I got that, but it is the ability for us to understand is somehow, somewhere, that action never leaves us as adults. We sit around and we say, man, I hope this happens, but we never do anything to ensure, partner with God to see our miracle. We just hope it happens. So many people in today's life, hope I get a house one day. Hope I pay off my house one day. Hope I have kids. Hope my kids kind of get what I believe and I place it in them. Like, we hope a lot, but we don't really do a lot. And in order to have legacy thinking, it requires this idea that doing actually does matter. Look at your neighbor and say, do something. Look at your other neighbor and say, do something. So the first thing we're going to do is learn how to transfer a dream to become a vision where we actually set goals and have something do. So the first way that you do that is you make the decision you're going to write it down. The Bible says write the vision down and make it plain that others can run with it. Why is that important? Because if it's a God-sized vision, guess who will never see it completely done? Everybody say me. You won't. If it's God-sized, it's meant to outlast you. It's meant to go to your kids. It's meant to go to your grandchildren. I mean, think about it. When God started this whole thing off with a cat named Noah, would Noah ever see it all go down? The answer is no. So if it's a God-sized vision, you need to understand, you're not going to see it happen. So you need to think, if I say think legacy. You need to think about your kids. You need to think about your grandkids. You need to think about what decisions am I making now that will impact my kids, my grandkids, their kids, and their kids, and their kids. Because God promised me if I get close to him, think like him, see life as he sees life, then he will bless, move on 1,000 generations beyond me. So you have to write it down so that other people will know what it is. You know the second thing you have to do? Tell somebody. You can't just write it in your little journal and keep it to yourself. You have to tell somebody. Now, somebody in here has a dream of opening a business, but you haven't written it down, and you haven't told anybody. You want to know why? Because you're afraid to. The reason people don't write it down is, you know what it becomes when you write it down? Real. Like, all of a sudden, you wrote it down, it's like, oh, snap, that's for real. There it is, on paper. And you won't tell anybody, and here's the reason I don't tell anybody, and I'll just be honest with you. I have some dreams still in there that I'm like, I'm not ready to let that out the box yet. You know why? Because I don't want anybody asking me about it. You know what friends are good at? Asking you how you're doing with what you're supposed to do. Paying no attention to what they're supposed to do. How many know that? It's like, you tell them, man, I'm dreaming about opening this business. Did you write it down? Yeah, I wrote it down. I'm telling you. All right, week by. Hey, what you doing? Well, I'm praying about it. Yeah, but what you doing? Well, I'm reading. I'm watching some YouTube videos. I'm trying to check out what are you doing? And whatever the week goes by, what'd you do this week? Well, you know, I'm YouTube videos. I mean, I'm digging it. Like, it's just this constant asking, which is this? Let's just be honest. Is a reminder of what I'm not doing to see happen what I've said I want to happen. If you want an unbelievable marriage, and you tell somebody that, you just better be getting ready that they're going to ask you, sir, what did you do practically this week to love your wife as Christ loved the church? And you're going to have to answer that. Ma'am, what did you do this week to honor your husband and submit to him as you do to God? And she's going to go, I ain't nothing. Because he ain't loving me as Christ loved the church. I mean, that's how it goes, right? I mean, it's this game. So here's what I'm just telling you. When you write it down And you tell somebody it's just transferred from a hope to an accountability place of where somebody asks you, what are you doing? What goals are you making? So let's just have some fun. So you have a goal of being married. Single people, write that down. Matter of fact, you can put it in your phone right now. And we're going to text somebody right now. But here's the deal. Don't write, I want to be married. Write the type of person and characteristics you want to be married to. Because if you're older and single, you just need them breathing. Right? That's where you're at now. You're like, if he can walk and has a job, I'm good. No, let's don't do that, okay? Let's try to, and listen, stay with it. Be faithful. Know that's what God's put in your heart, and that's really why. So do that. You're in here and you want kids. Write that down. And listen, be bold. Right now, I want two boys and a little girl. And however that plays out for you. And I get it. When you say, I would like a little boy and God delivers you a daughter, be thankful. I'm not saying that. But I mean, like, start to exercise your faith and begin to speak over things and believe God to do those because God's put that in your heart. That's what visions are. God, you didn't just think that on your own. God put that in your heart, so it's time for you to get serious about it. Write it down. Call out for what it is. You want to own your own home. Listen to me, write that down, and then write out the best home that you want. Understanding this, God likes a process. So what does that mean? That means that your 25-year-old self, you're not going to have the same house that your 40-year-old parents do. There's a starting place. Like we don't come out the womb as successful as our parents. So there's something we have to go through. There's a training ground we have to go through. But do not shorten or lessen your vision just because you know that's going to happen. Like know that's how it's going to begin, and you'll begin to make really good decisions to get you there. Write down that you want your promotion. Tell a trusted friend and what that looks like, and even the monetary value that you think that's going to bring. Give me another one. Okay, weight. You want to lose weight. There are a few people will write down the weight they're losing, but they don't write down their target weight. This is how much I want to lose. So go ahead and write that down. Tell four people. Don't just tell one. Tell four people so they can remind you all the time. And whatever this is for you, whatever the visions are, and I know we've kept them pretty light, but this will just get you started. How do I move them from dreams to visions? You write them down, and then you tell somebody. And then now you're going to begin to make decisions. Everybody say goals. There are about, in ourselves, there's five kinds of decisions we make. There are actually six in the universe, but there are five that we stay in. The first one is this. Everybody say worse. How many of you ever made worse decisions? There's going to be a test later, so go ahead and own it now so you don't have to say it later and go, man, I didn't raise my hand a while ago. So how many of you ever made worse decisions? Like you look at something and go, that was terrible. Okay, how many of you ever made bad decisions? It's a bad decision not to raise your hand. Okay. How many of you ever made good decisions? All right, worse, bad, good. Have you ever made better? Everybody say better. Now look, everybody in here raise your hand. Because if you ever made worse, then surely to goodness, you've made a better decision. So we can't say everybody. Okay, so then there's best. There are best decisions. So here's the five that we typically function in humanity. We make worse, bad, good, better, and best. This is the decision place that we kind of function from. Now, worst decisions are pretty easy to, am I making those? You're going to know that. If you're making bad decisions, you're going to know that. If you're making good decisions, I'm going to give you a way to know if you're making good decisions. You're not going to jail anymore. That's what good decisions are this, what you're supposed to do. Like, that's what good decisions are. You're not looking at porn. You're not cheating on your wife. You're not smoking crack. You're not, you know. Well, I'm sorry, like, you didn't get a DUI this year. That's a good decision. Like, you went to work on time every day for a month. That's a good decision. Like, those are good decisions. Better and best decisions. And so what you want to do in life is you want to grow to each level. Everybody say next level. And this is so difficult for people to understand, because here's what the enemy starts to tell you, and a lot of people start to tell you. You up here in this world, and you think you better than me. Here's what everybody's going to tell you. I told you when we started this conversation, this is what you're going to hear when you decide to go to your next level. You done started changing the way you think, talking, and acting. Now you think you're better than me. No. I'm not better than you. I'm just better than where I'm at. Everybody in this room, you are better than where you currently reside in your thinking, your belief system, and your life. What am I saying? There is a new level for you. Now, there are some people in this room who went, not for me. I'm solid. Let me tell you where you are. You are telling me you've made the best decisions you've ever made in your life. You've already identified yourself. I'm like, shoot, I go to church. I get to work on time. I do all kinds. I mean, I made the best decision I've ever made last year. I am solid. You are in more danger than this person. You want to know why? Because if I could, like, challenge you, this is typically where religious people get. And this is the reason people right here don't come to church. Because you tell them to be like you, and you think you got it all together, and you don't think you need to change, and you think this conversation is a waste of time, but what you fail to realize is there's one more level. That is an infinite level that you never, ever, ever, ever arrive on. Let me tell you what that thinking is. Everybody say legacy. It's called legacy thinking. Legacy means this: something you create during your life solely to benefit future generations, something you may see come to pass or never see come to pass. This is not thinking about now. This is not thinking about you. This is thinking about your children, their grandchildren. This is thinking 1,000 generations after you. Most people only ever make good decisions. Some people make better. Fewer make best. Very, very, very few ever learn to make legacy decisions. Let me tell you what good decisions don't do. Good decisions don't get you your vision. They just don't. You just exist in life. You take up space, and you live a pretty good life. What do I mean? You kind of stay out of trouble, and that's okay. And the reason it's so hard for us to get here, if I say legacy, is because most people focus on the end game. If I say teach me. The Bible says, teach us to number our days. So I was thinking, how can God help me? How can you teach me to number my days? So I wrote a timeline. 76 is the average lifespan of you. If you live in America, if you live in the world, and there's birth to 76. Most people, if you get your attention brought, where do we usually get our attention kind of brought to our senses? It's in the hospital when we visit a friend. How many know that? You visit a friend, they're beeping and dinging, and they got all this stuff on them. Or you go to a funeral, and you go, man, the end's coming. So most of us only ever focus on the end. Let me tell you what happens when you do that. You panic. And what that forces you to do, you don't even realize it, is it makes you make now decisions. You go, I got to do this now. I got to get this done right now. I got to get this done for me. Because if I don't, I'm going to run out of, everybody say time. Tomorrow, what's tomorrow? What's happening tomorrow? Yes, somebody said it. National championship. I don't care, but anyway, for all the people in here that do. How many of y'all fired up about tomorrow's national championship ball game? I'm any Clemson fans in here? They didn't say anything, just. How many legit Alabama fans in here? How many non-Alabama fans just gonna go ahead and be on their side anyway? Okay, so I do hope I do hope that Alabama wins, but the truth is, I don't think I got to do a lot of hope, and I think they're going to win. Now, here's why. Here's why. And this is very important. Because I think Alabama, they don't have a coach. They have one of the greatest leaders. And I would put Nick Saban in the top 10 leaders, honestly, at least in this country. I really would. I kind of watch him. I kind of read behind him. Why? Because it's not because I'm interested in football. It's because I'm interested in leadership. And he has the ability to cause his team to do something that other teams don't do. Other teams start the season out focusing on the end, on the championship. I can't wait till we get to the championship. Yeah, but you got like 27 games between now and that. So like they start out the entire season with the end in mind. And let me tell you what happens to them. About midway through the season, their championship dreams are over. Because all they did was focus on the end. So I watched an interview. It was when they were entering the playoffs. And they sat one of the teammates down. I don't remember who it was, but they were asking him about, hey, what are you thinking about coming out of this season, going into the playoffs? Can you tell us what the championship is going to look like? And he totally evaded the question, didn't even answer the question about the championship. He said, Coach Saban says, if you listen to the players, they say that all the time. Coach Saban says, we're entering a new season. Last season's over. Translation, everything we did last season really don't matter. It's all about this game. It's all about this practice. It's all about this sprint. It's all about this sled drive. It's all about this block today, right here and now. It's not about, I'm not even going to talk about that. Coach Saban was even an interview, I think it was last week. He was speaking on legacy. Everybody say legacy. And he said, my team's legacy will hinge on what they do in the next game. Can I tell you what the next game is after that interview? Championship game. What was Nick Saban saying? It don't matter what we've done back here. Because you know what everybody in this room will remember? Whether they were the first place losers or the first place winners. Listen, I'm just going to tell you, the season's coming to an end, and whether they win or lose, in that one game is all that will matter in the history and legacy of that football team. Nick Saban thinks legacy, and until a person trains themselves to make championship decisions instead of focusing on the championship, they will never win. The people who win are those who train themselves to make championship decisions every day, every week, every month, and they wake up in the championship only to win the championship. It just boggled me forever. Why is Alabama winning 27,000 championships every stinking year? Can nobody beat them? Not until they change the way they think. Nick Saban has led that team to championship decision-making, not a championship. Look at me. That's how God thinks. What are you saying? I'm saying whether Nick Saban is a believer or not, he really understands how God looks at life. He says, you guys are too focused on the end. And God would say, I need you to start making wise decisions. God, how do I make wise decisions? Oh, man, Psalms 90 says, teach me to number my days that I may gain a heart of wisdom. I don't need you to worry about the end because your end is sealed. What I need you to worry about is the decision you make today and how it affects not your funeral, your kids and your grandkids and their grandkids. Can I tell you what I have not done until the last year? Thought that way. Teach us, everybody say teach me. Teach us to number our days. Well, let's just do that. 38, 57, 19, let's see, 5, 12, 21, 60. You're like, what does that mean? Well, we're just going to have some fun. Everybody say fun. Look at your neighbor and say, now be honest. Okay, so this is cool. From birth to 5, what kind of decisions do you make? Somebody say none. you, like, part of this, you can't even hold your head up and you poop your pants. Like, you know, no decision. And it's like somebody's telling you that carrots are good, and you're going, they're not good. Okay, so like, so from 0 to 5, there's no decision making. And then you get in something called kindergarten, and your greatest decision is what color crayon you're going to eat so your poop is purple. Like, that's it. How many know that's true? All right, so that's, okay. So then you get in elementary school, okay? I'm in elementary school. Who can even remember the decisions you made in elementary school? They're still like 80%, maybe 90% are still made for you. You don't get to, you know, I had to wear Husky jeans because that's what my mom said I was wearing. There were no such thing as skinny jeans then. And I wore, you know, certain kind of tennis shoes with a Velcro on so nobody had to tie my shoes. Everybody got, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's just, everybody makes decisions for you. So there's really, the first 12 years is out. No, all your decisions are made for you. Now, here's what I want you to understand. What are we taught? This is important. What are we taught to do in these years? We're taught to make good decisions. How many parents ground your kids for not making good decisions? What are good decisions? Pick up your room. Like, kids, look at me. Why? Because you're supposed to. Like, it's just, like, come in at this time, eat your peas and carrots, do your homework. Like, there's all this stuff. Can I tell you what you're training your child to do? And there is no conversation. And this is not bad. This is just, we need to get this so we can learn how to elevate and move up and do greater things. Nobody talks about this to kids because we're afraid they can't handle it. But the truth is, these are the most formative years of your life. This is the place that you want to teach them that. You want them to think way out. Now, you may have to cut it up to train them, but you want to teach them how to think legacy. So we go into what is known as high school. How do you remember high school? Remember high school? Come on. Okay, so we went into high school. How many of you made bad decisions in high school? Middle school, high school, bad decisions. Raise your hand. Be proud. Say amen or something. Okay. All right, so like, 80% of this room. How many of you made good decisions in high school? Predominantly, like overarching, good. Yeah, your hands went down. Like, well, you know, 4 or 5. Okay, so like, how many of you in here, just by show of hands, middle school, high school, predominantly, you made better decisions? Well, you're putting your hand up and putting it down real fast. Are you afraid I'm actually going to call on you? What are you doing? I don't know. Okay. Okay, if you did, good. But here's what I want you to understand. Every time I teach this, doesn't matter where I teach this, overarchingly, middle school and high school, we make bad decisions. Let me say, I just lost ground. Go ahead. College. How many of you graduated college? Raise your hand. About a quarter of the room. How many of you didn't? So you didn't raise your hand just then, so raise your hand now. Okay, well, I got a certificate. I know, but I'm just going somewhere with this. So raise your hand. You didn't, okay. How many of you that were in college, graduated or not, made bad decisions in college? Wow, that's more people than said they went to college. What are y'all doing? You're just going, well, around that age, they weren't good either. So, okay, so let me just tell you, and listen, this is going to get better. I'm not trying to make us feel bad. I just want us to understand where our life is headed. And God says, I need to teach you to number your days. I need you to understand you don't have as much time as you think, and it's time for you to come out of this hole, okay? So from 12 to 21, because none of this matters, you made all bad decisions. Now something happens around 25. How many people in here are 25 and over? Raise your hand. 25 and over. Okay, so a lot of people. Some people didn't raise your hand. I can look at you. You are 25 and over. That's okay. From 25 to about 38, studies show, here's what you make. Everybody say good. Everybody say good. You make good decisions. Can I tell you why you make good decisions somewhere around 25? Because you got sick of getting a DUI. Like, you were tired of waking up early in the morning and puking in the toilet. How many of that guy? Okay. I prayed a lot in those days, but I'm not really sure to who. Okay, so like, you got tired of getting possession charges. You probably went through a divorce and didn't want to go through another one. You made decisions that didn't give you a good relationship with your kids. You found yourself in a lot of debt. Here's what happened. You woke up somewhere around 25, 28, and you went, this is dumb. None of this is good. None of this is, so here's what I'm doing. I'm changing. I'm going to make good decisions. Here's all you said to yourself. You didn't realize it. I'm just not going to go to jail anymore. I'm not going to get traffic tickets. I'm not going to get written up at work. I'm not going to lose that job again. I'm not going to go through another marriage. I mean, I'm going to make good decisions. You probably even said this out loud to somebody. You know what I'm going to start doing this year? Make good decisions. And listen, that's good. Like, celebrate the move from bad to good. But here's what I want you to understand. In no way do good decisions bring you to your vision. You're just doing what you're supposed to do. That's it. Like, you know you're supposed to be at work on time, right? Like, we're all solid with that, right? You know it's not normal to get 5 tickets in a year. Talking to myself. Like, that's not, like, you know it's, okay, you, like, you know it's not normal to wake up with somebody in a bedroom you don't know about. Like, that, none of that, like, you know it's not normal to look at porn every day or once a day. Like, it's not normal. It's why the Bible says, don't conform to the pattern of the world. What's the world say, guys? Look, just make good decisions. And what the world does is rob you of God-sized dreams, which are called visions. This is not good. So what you want to do is be able to move to better, to best, ultimately, to legacy. We're going to talk about next week, what do each one look like and how do I move from one tier to the next to get to where I need to be. Some people right here, everybody say 38, have what's known as a midlife crisis. Have you ever been through one of those? Don't raise your hand. Here's what that means. It means, holy crap, I'm 38 and I don't have anything. I am not where I wanted to be by this time. And so here's what people in midlife crisis do. They change stuff. They feel like life is Walmart, and they use the return policy. They trade their current wife in, get another one. They realize they're going to keep the same kids, but they get some more kids because that's married in. They change jobs, like they change underwear. I mean, they just start changing they change stuff. And can I tell you what happens to a person who changes stuff but doesn't introduce a new system of belief? They marry the same woman. They marry the same man. They parent the same way. They have the same job. Everything's the same. It's just a different color. Because stuff is not your problem. Somebody in here is thinking about trading your spouse in 2017. Can I just tell you, if you don't get what I'm saying, you're going to marry the same person again. You're going to be the same person again. Like, nothing about your life is going to change except stuff. That's called a midlife crisis. So what I would love people to get, and what took me a while to get, like, I'm 43, I'm just now grasping this. So the stretch is for me to be used by God to help you understand a powerful truth in God's kingdom. You don't need to think good, you don't need to think better, you don't need to think best. You need to think as God thinks, see life as God sees life, so you can make decision God's way. Why? Because I want to leave something for my children to stand on, for my grandchildren to stand on. I want my legacy to outlast me. So if you're in here and you're around this age, which is the average age that comes to Epic, it's time to change the way you think, because you and I don't have time. I'm going to say, teach me. Teach me, God, to number my days that I may gain. Who gains when we number our days? Everybody say me. I may gain a heart of wisdom. What's that mean? At 43, I'll just use me for an example. At 43, I don't have time to make a bad decision. I don't. I got 14 years till it's a third over. I don't have time to make bad ones. I don't have time to make good ones. I don't even have time to get stuck right here because I think I've got it all together. What I have time to do is submit my life to God and say, God, give me a heart of wisdom. Teach me to number my days so that when I am gone, my kids stand on my success and learn from my failures. Allow me to place into my children and those who come after me the wisdom that you have allowed me to gain so that they do well. Because everybody in this room focuses on, everybody say retire. Who wants to retire? No, it's okay. I'm not gonna hammer you, but I want you to understand how the United States teaches us to think. How many of you legitimately think, at least some level, retire? Raise your hand. Okay, let me tell you what that translates to in America. Everybody say quit. Who's ready when it's over? I mean, that's what it is. It's like, oh man, I got like 17 years and I can quit. How many feel like beach house, what's something, my kid, I'm gonna have a bunch of kids so they can make some money, take care of me, wipe my butt because I wipe theirs. Like, I gotta do something. So, how many just feel like when I get to 60, I am done. Y'all can have it. Okay, so let me help you understand why that's dangerous. Because in the Bible, there is no biblical model for retirement. Go check me. Read it from Genesis to Revelations. Get back to me when you're done. Take you a while. It's not in there. Why? Because all you see in Scripture is the way God thinks. You know how God thinks? God thinks legacy. Who loves football? I know there's more than six people in here that love football. You just all lost your mind when I said championship game tomorrow. So who loves football? Thank you for being honest in church. You made a good decision. Okay. Three. Okay. Eight minutes. Football, in my opinion, can, in analogy-wise, mirror life. According to seeing life the way God sees life, there's four quarters to life. In football, when you come out and play the first quarter, and we'll just use Alabama as a reference. Alabama really, and it, like this is just true, they don't really play the first quarter well. Like if I want to talk to Nick about something, it'd be that. Like, man, you can motivate these guys in the fourth. Can't we do something about the first? Come on, man. Okay, so like, but why? The truth is, nobody plays the first quarter well. They really don't. I mean, think about it. In life, your first 12 years, you're not playing. You're trying to figure the game out. You're trying to say, who am I? What clothes do I want to wear? What group do I want to fit in? What does God have for me? What does it look like? You're feeling out the game, knowing the adjustments you'll make in the second quarter. This is what Alabama does. And we all think they don't play it really well. Actually, they play it really well. They watch the other team. And they play their game. And if I was going to encourage any high schooler, any middle schooler, anybody that has children, here's what you need to tell them. In the first quarter, play your game. Don't try to play somebody else's game. Don't try to be somebody you're not. Don't try to conform to what people tell you that you should be. Play your game. Because God created you to play it a certain way. So actually, Alabama does play it well. So they play it really well, which looks like they don't, but they do. And so that's what the first quarter is designed for. You're not supposed to come into this world super, uber successful and be a winner. You're supposed to come into this world and just be you. That's what the first quarter is. But the second quarter, I've kind of figured that out. That's the hope. Like if you're in here and you're in high school, please don't hear this message be, you're just going to make some mistakes. Hear this message be that there is at least a family you have here who believes in legacy thinking. We want to share with you the mistakes that we made. And so in the first quarter, you can figure out who you are. That's why shift is so important. Quest is so important. Journey is so important. Let us teach them who they are in Christ so they don't try to play somebody else's game. So when they're in the second quarter, which, by the way, is when all people fall out of church, college age years, they're still here connected to this family doing great things, playing a sick second quarter. That's what it should look like. So people should play well in the second quarter. So when you go into halftime, you're not stressed. How many of you ever played football, went into halftime stressed? How many of you know when we go into halftime, we have to be what? What do we have to be going into halftime? Everybody say up. Come on, everybody say up. Don't lose this. This is very powerful. We want to be up. You know why? Because we don't want to come out in the third quarter and be behind. We don't. Most people in America, behind, because nobody teaches us this. What would it be like to play on a football team, you went into the locker room, and nobody threw an igloo cooler? What would it be like to go into a locker room and nobody headbutt lockers or throw cups or dog cuss you or like pitch a fit? Who played on that football team? Everybody in here, raise your hand, because you lived in this area. I know all the coaches here. Okay, so like it's just, they lose their mind. Why? Because 9 times out of 10, we go into halftime, we're down. Can I just tell you, 9 times out of 10 in American life, we go into halftime down. And we have a midlife crisis. We go, oh my gosh. And coaches who are not good, I've seen it happen. Change stuff. Hey, you don't run the ball anymore. Let you run the ball. I'm going to move you to tight end. Listen, that's the worst thing you can do at halftime. But I've seen coaches do it. I've seen people do it. Hey, don't want to be married to you anymore because you're crazy. Don't really want to hang around y'all too much. I'm going to change that job. It's the same thing, and we understand it. Even women understand it in football. And I'm not saying women don't understand football, but y'all look at that and go, why'd that coach do that? That just doesn't make any sense. That was a great tight end. And y'all, you guys even question it when it's supposed to be a guy game. Let me just tell you, it's the same. It's life. Don't change stuff. Change the way you think. And then you find yourself in the third quarter. If you come out and you hammer in the third quarter, you've played the first quarter, the second quarter, and the third quarter well, you're going to come into the fourth quarter. Have you ever been to a ball game and they do this? Everybody raise up. Let's do it. Because y'all gonna do it tomorrow night. In your living room, as if you're at the game, you're like, come on, Nick. Come on. You're gonna pray against Clemson. I already feel it. I know you are. You're gonna be, in the name of Jesus, let somebody turn their ankle. That's how y'all are. Okay? Crazy. All right, so like, I don't like this. You know why I don't like this? Because if you are behind enough in the fourth quarter, this don't help you. It may make you feel good. This is not going to dig you out of a hole. This is not going to make you not be behind. All you're doing is waving bye early. First suck, second, third suck, two, fourth is awful. Okay, so let's just be honest. So what should happen and what Alabama does well is about the first 4 minutes of the fourth quarter, first string is in grinding, just like they were grinding in the third, just like they were grinding in the second, just like they were grinding in the first. And the last 8 minutes, what does almost every game, what does Alabama do? What do they do? They put the second string in. And you know what the second string doesn't have to do? Win the game. You know what the second string does? Goes in, gets some experience, and is now cheered on and coached by seniors or upperclassmen. Watch the games. Go back and watch the games. When the upperclassmen come off the field, when they're transitioning between offense and defense, I want you to look at who talks to them. It's not Nick. It's the players. It's the players encouraging them. It's the players cheering them on, and they're saying, hey man, you know what, don't worry about that, if that fumble, don't worry about that, because you're going to do better next time. Like, they're just speaking life into them, they're encouraging them, they're helping them get better, they're giving them experience in an environment where they're not under pressure to win, they're under pressure to enjoy the game. Now, you say, how does that work in life? That's what life should look like. Retirement is not to quit. Retirement is to put the freshmen in. Who are the freshmen? Our kids, our teenagers, our college-age students. What are we supposed to do as older people? Man, cheer them on. Not to win the game. Not to try to figure out how to take care of me. Because you know what I've done? Because I thought legacy, I've got money set up to take care of you and me. I just want to see you do well. I don't want you to go out and make the same mistake. I've already adjusted for the game. I figured out the system. Let me take it out and put it in you. And when you make a mistake, I'm not going to dig on you. I'm going to say, man, don't worry about that fumble. That's all right. You're going to do better next time. There's greatness in you. Just let it come out. Go in and have a good time. Enjoy the game, because I've played it, and you're going to stand on my shoulders. And what we have made will impact your kids, my grandkids, your grandkids, because our family believes in legacy. The family at Epic believes in legacy. Now, I know what you're saying. Because when I do this and I talk about it and I use this in counseling sessions in different places, this is almost always what somebody says. If the job is in the last quarter to be cheered on, I got to be honest, Pastor, I don't have anybody to cheer me on. I'm the first of my family to make a decision to even remotely think like this. I'm the first to come to church. I'm the first to get saved. I'm the first to try to better myself because my family line is full of bad decisions. So, I mean, I appreciate it, but you just need to know there is nobody on the sideline cheering me on. My middle son, Joshua, is being recruited right now by some colleges. And last week... there was a college from out in the Midwest that came in to see him. And I'm not going to use the name of the school, but anyway, they came in and they were like, hey, what's the name of the linebacker y'all have playing for you again? He said, his name's Josh Marsh. And they said, I recruited his daddy. Now, that kind of threw me back a little bit. I was like, Josh, you mean there's a coach coaching college that recruited me? That dude's old. It's been a long time since I've been in college. It was pretty impressive because usually, you know, college coaches, they move and do all this stuff. And I said, well, what'd he say? He said, well, you know, Coach Adcock, he said to him, he said, I recruited his daddy. It's his daddy's name, Ivy Marsh. And Coach Adcock was like, yeah. He said, you know, he's a pastor of a church over across town called Epic Church. And the coach from this college went, well, I ain't the same guy. I ain't the same guy I recruited. Now, there's always an impression you want to make on a recruiter, but that's not the one. I was like, really? I changed. Okay, so, but Coach Adcock told me, he said, no, I've heard the stories, and a lot of people have. And he said, he's changed. He's doing it. He said, well, you know, I'd never thought that guy would have been a preacher. So I get that a lot. So why am I telling you that story? Because I'm just going to be honest with you. The enemy... when you make a decision to do this, the enemy will want to remind you of the reasons you can't. But I think it's actually, if you let it, if you change the way you think, it can be a gift from God to know if you brought me from here to here, then I know you can take me from here to here. Hebrews said this. I want to encourage everybody who comes from something like me and you feel like you're the first and you don't know if there's going to be encouragement there. I want to read to you from the Bible. Hebrews 12 says this. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run this race with perseverance that has been marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Look at your neighbor and say, heaven's got your back. Look at your other neighbor and say, heaven's got your back. I want you to understand something today, regardless of what you're going through. Hebrews 12 says, you have a legacy of faith. Witnesses to what God can do and how he can do it that from heaven are cheering you on. So everybody that kind of close their eyes, and I want you to understand that from eternity, Noah is cheering somebody on in this auditorium, saying, I know what it's like for God to ask you to do something stupid that nobody's ever seen. I mean, God asked me to build a boat, and it hadn't even rained. He kept talking about some kind of flood or something, but I stepped in by faith, and I did that. And the thing that God's calling you to do that you don't see how it's going to work out, can I just tell you, man, I got your back. I understand. You can do this. You can step in and by faith do what God has called you to do. Joseph from eternity would say, I know what it's like have a dream and your family hates you for that dream. they ridicule you for that dream, and you may have to go through a pit and a prison, but I'm telling you, that dream is not just for you. It is for the whole world, and the family that has condemned you, that is for them too. You're gonna make a way where it seems to be no way. I know you feel like you've come up short, but I'm telling you, God can turn anything into a miracle if you'll just have faith. Joseph echoes from eternity, says, I got your back. Jacob says, man, I know what it's like to be a street hustler. So manipulative that God actually had to break my hip and change my name so that I would understand and listen to him. But I'm just telling you, when you think you have nothing to offer, God can step into your environment and change it on a dime to make you leave an inheritance, a legacy for 1,000 generations. Jacob says, don't tout the power of God to use the life that seems unusable. I've been there. You can do this. Isaac would say, I know what it's like to have two twins that are driving you crazy. Let's just get practical. You got some kids that are going nuts. You're not really sure which one is going to be a blessing and which one's not, and they're getting a little sideways. But I'm telling you, if you will lead, if you will stay a father and you will speak life over them, both of them will actually do great things in the earth. It's not one or the other. Isaac says, I got you. I got your back. Peter says from eternity to somebody in this auditorium, listen, I know what it's like to deny God. I know what it's like to turn your back on him. To just be frustrated with how things are going down because they're not living up to your expectations. But I'm just telling you from heaven, step back into what he has for you, because God is merciful. God is loving. He's just asking you today from eternity, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? I know Peter would say from eternity, you can have everything that God says you can have. He loves you more than you love him. And when you mess up, your mess ups are turned into gifts by other people. I know because I've been there. You can do this. Don't quit on God. Thomas says, I know what it means to doubt. So much so that you have the audacity to ask God, I'll only believe if you let me stick my finger in the wounds. From experience, can I tell you, Thomas would say from heaven, from experience, God's not afraid of your doubts and God's not afraid of your questions. He will show up and show you that he is real. If you have the audacity to be honest about your doubts and where you are and say, God, would you move on my life? Can I just tell you from experience, I walked into a room and I was blown away. You got this. You can do this. This is for somebody. Lazarus would say, I know what it's like to be sick and need a healing and to call on God only to think he's running behind. He's a little bit late. But I'm just telling you from experience, your resurrection, your healing is coming. It may not look like you think it's going to look like. It may not come when you want it to come, but can I just tell you, Lazarus would say from heaven, Jesus is never late. Jesus is always faithful. Jesus does what he says he's going to do, when he's going to do it. You just need to have faith. Take it from somebody whose faith wavered and his sisters got a little sideways. Can I just tell you, God is good and he is faithful no matter what you're going through. He will make a way where there seems no way. Your resurrection is coming. The Bible says Jesus sat down at the right hand of the Father. Like if all those are not good enough to hear echoing from eternity, you got this. Come on, you can do it. Lay all that stuff aside. Fight the fight of faith because God has greatness. He wants you to think as he thinks. He wants you to see as he sees so you can do as he does. Jesus says, I got your back. Mine was beaten so you can be forgiven. When your mind gets crazy, a crown of thorns were placed over my head so I could give you my mind. If your eyes stay fixed on Jesus, perfect peace is what you have. When you feel like you've done wrong and gone places and made mistakes and done things, can I just tell you, Jesus says from heaven, I got you back. You're forgiven. You're whole. You're redeemed. You're made new. There is nothing you cannot do with me moving in your life and empowering you to make legacy decisions. You just need to make the decision today to give him your whole life. And the trade is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, goodness, and self-control. Everybody say legacy. The trade is legacy. So I don't know where you're at today, but can I tell you, there are a great cloud of witnesses in heaven today cheering you on. When everybody comes against you, when everybody talks about you, when everybody condemns you, when everybody says you think you're better than this, there is heaven itself. Noah, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Peter, Paul, Jesus himself standing on the edge of eternity. Mary, Rahab, a prostitute who said, I couldn't be used because of my past, but she chose to step into faith and hide some visitors to her country. And God allowed her to be the great, 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 great grandma of Jesus. All of heaven says, you got this. God is not too far that he cannot be found or talked to. He is right here with you. And all of heaven says, I got you back. Father God, thank you so much for today. Thank you. Thank you that you got our back. And you call us, invite us, encourage us to imitate not just what you do. The first invitation is to have faith in you, to believe in you, to think as you think, to see life as you see life. Teach us, oh God, to number our days that we would gain a heart of wisdom, that our decisions would not be about us or about now, but they would be made in order that 1,000 generations would be affected by our love for you. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.